أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, I welcome you with a universal salutation of Islam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. The meaning of this for our non-Muslim friends in the audience is, may the peace, mercy and blessings of Allah, God, be upon you all. We at the IPC London branch are very honored indeed to have a scholar of the caliber of Sheikh Ahmed Didat in our midst today. But we are also just as much honored to have a dedicated Muslim of the caliber of Dr. Yaqub Zaki in our midst also. He will be the chairman for the meeting, and he has taken the trouble to come all the way from Scotland, and we appreciate that very much. I'll now hand over to the chairman to continue proceedings. Dr. Zaki.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم من الصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين أحمد محمد المصطفى وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أما بعد. Brothers and sisters in Islam, distinguished guests, in the name of the Islamic Propagation Center, I bid you welcome to today's events. Before the main feature, which is the speech by Ahmed Didat, begins, we shall have a reading from the Quran, Tilawat al-Quran, by Qari Muhammad Farooq.
A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajeem. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Inna Ibrahim kana ummatan qanitan lillah لله حنيفا ولم يك من المشركين شاكرا لأنعمه اجتباه وهداه إلى صراط مستقيم وآتيناه في الدنيا حسنة وإنه في الآخرة لمن الصالحين ثم أوحينا ملة إبراهيم حنيفا وما كان من المشركين إنما جعل السبت على الذين اختلفوا فيه
سبحان الله
وإن ربك ليحكم بينهم يوم القيامة فيما كانوا فيه يوم القيامة فيما كانوا فيه يختلفون. ادع إلى سبيل ربك بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة وجادلهم بالتي هي أحسن وجادلهم بالتي هي أحسن إن ربك هو أعلم بمن ضل عن سبيله إن ربك هو أعلم بمن ضل عن سبيله وهو أعلم بالمهتدين. صدق الله العظيم.
The basic division in the classification of religions is between ethnic and universal religions. There only are three universal religions in the whole world: Buddhism, Christianity, and Islam. So you don't, in fact, have very much choice. All of the other religions in the world, thousands of them, are ethnic religions, and Judaism is an ethnic religion. I do not think I would be doing the Jews any disservice if I said that Judaism does not claim to be a solution to the world's problems, but only a solution to the problems of the Jews. I shall therefore be very interested to see how the speaker deals with this subject, which of course is of great interest to us, in that Judaism, like Islam and Christianity, is also an Abrahamic faith. I am confident that the speaker will do justice to his subject, because Ahmed Didat is a household name. He is one of the few Muslims to have mastered the discipline and technique of comparative religion. I have long believed that the greatest weakness of the Muslims in their encounter with members of other faiths is their ignorance of the principles of comparative religion. This you can see any time that you watch a debate between Muslims and Christians, or between Muslims, Christians and Jews on television. Invariably, the Muslim speaker covers himself with ridicule and in the process invites not a little discredit on Islam. This is to be attributed to the fact that there is not a single department of comparative religion anywhere in the Muslim world. For this reason, it is all the more important that an individual like Ahmed Didat should have devoted his life to the study of comparative religion. I shall therefore be most interested to hear what he has to say, and I have pleasure in introducing to you the speaker. Ahmed Didat will speak for about 45 to 60 minutes, after which there will be an opportunity to ask questions. Sheikh Ahmed Didat.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الدين عند الله الإسلام صدق الله صدق الله المولانا العظيم. Mr. Chairman and brethren, I read to you a very brief sentence from the Holy Quran, from Surah, meaning chapter, Ali Imran. You owe it to yourself, Muslims as well as non-Muslims, to get hold of a copy of the Holy Quran. I said Muslims as well as non-Muslims. The non-Muslims, they must know, they owe it to themselves, that since there are 1 billion Muslims in the world today, they ought to know how their minds are working. Even as a missionary, you want to fight the Muslims, an intellectual battle, even then you need the book to arm yourself as to what the other person believes and what his book of authority is. And for the Muslim, it's also imperative that in this environment, English-speaking environment, that each and every Muslim here ought to arm himself with an English translation of the Holy Quran. This particular one I have in my hand is by Abdullah Yusuf Ali. This volume has about 2,000 pages. And in it, how will you find Imran? There are 114 chapters. And this was only one of the 114. How will you find Imran? Can anybody tell me? Index, yes. You see, this particular one here has a very comprehensive index. At the back of it, what you want to know? Our Qari, the young man who recited to us so beautifully, he was reading from Surah Nahl. Where will you find Nahl? I said, go to the index. It'll tell you chapter 16, around verse 120, he was speaking about Abraham. The father of the Jews, the father of the Christians, and the father of the Muslims. I don't know why he chose that verse, because there was no communication between me and the reciter as to what he should read. But as if he was telling us, don't forget Abraham. Abraham is the father of the Jews and the Christians and the Muslims. He's spoken of in the verses he recited that Abraham was an upright person going straight towards God. And he was not of those who associate other beings with God. And in that chapter, again in the verses he read, the principles of religious preaching. He says, Udu'u ila sabili rabbika bil hikmati. Say, invite all to the ways of thy Lord with wisdom. Wal maw'izatil hasanati, and with beautiful preaching. Wajadilhum billati ahsan, and reason with them in the ways that are best and most gracious. Chapter 16, ayah number 125. Our Qari read it to us, as if instructing me as well as you, that look, these are the principles of religious talk, discussion, dialogue. So in Surah Ali Imran, chapter 3, ayah number 19, verse 19, Allah Bari Ta'ala tells us, he tells the whole of humanity, addressed to mankind, say, Inna Dida Indallahi Islam, most certainly the religion or the deen, the way to God, acceptable to God Almighty, is Islam. Another place Allah says, وَمَنْ يَبْتَغِي غَيْرَ الْإِسْلَامِ دِينًا فَلَنْ يُقْبَلَ مِنْهُ وَهُوَ فِي الْآخِرَةِ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. That if anyone chooses a religion other than the religion of Islam, he has lost in the hereafter, he has no place. So, what about Judaism? What about Christianity? When we say that Islam is the only way, is there no such thing as Judaism? Is there no such thing as Christianity? No, there are such systems. Then what does the Quran say? Allah does not accept anything but Islam. Only Islam, submission to God's will. That is what he wants. So now I have to satisfy the chairman and you, my brothers and sisters. How do I justify the statement of the Quran? No Judaism, no Christianity, but Islam. I am telling you, it's quite easy, very easy. You see, the Judaism came before Christianity and before Islam. That is what the whole world will tell you. Moses lived long before Jesus and long before the Holy Prophet Muhammad. Anybody will tell you that. But I am asking any Jew, you ask any Jew, what is your religion? And he will tell you his religion is Judaism. So I ask him, you can ask the Jew, Is this in your Torah? We in Arabic say Torah. The first five books of Moses. The Jews say is the Torah, meaning the law. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers and Deuteronomy. The first five books of the Holy Bible. Is it in there, your Torah? Like what we say, the Quran is to us, the Torah is to the Jew. Is it in your Torah? This word Judaism? He will tell you no. Is it in your Mishnah, your secondary source of information, your commentaries? He says no. If he knows anything at all about his religion, he'll tell you no. The word Judaism is not in the Torah, is not in the Mishnah, is not in the Talmud. So you see now, he's got to say it's not there. If he said it is, he said, show me where. He hasn't got it. Where did the word come from? Now we want to know, where did you get it? So if he knows, he will explain to you that this term Judaism was created, concocted, actually by the non-Jews. You see, the non-Jews in Palestine, they were looking down upon the Jews, and they said that the religion followed by the children of Judah in Judea is Judaism. Moses didn't say that. David or Solomon, he didn't utter the word. They'd never heard the term Judaism. Jesus never heard the word Judaism. This was a term invented by people from the outside, disparagingly pointing to the Jews, that the children, that the religion of the children of Judah in Judea is Judaism. And they liked the term and they adopted it. It is not in the Torah, it is not in the Mishnah, it is not in the Talmud. If there's any Jew here who knows any better than that, I would like to hear from him or her. Then what was the religion taught by Moses? We believe that the holy prophet Moses was a true messenger of God. God was directly in communication with him. And whatever he gave in his time to his people was from God. We accept that. But what was his religion? Because he never heard the term Judaism. If Moses was alive with us here today, or if on the other side, if we have the good fortune of meeting Moses and shaking his hands, and if we asked him, oh Moses, what is your religion? Since he didn't hear the term Judaism, he can't say Judaism. I expect him to say that my religion is a religion of total submission to God's will. A beautiful definition for the teaching of God. My religion is a religion of total submission to God's will. And I'm responding, I'm telling him, I'll tell him that one word for that in the Arabic language is Islam. Islam means exactly that in one word. Islam is a religion of total submission to God's will. So what he was teaching was Islam. Maybe he himself didn't know the term Islam, but that is the definition he's giving of Islam. So, the teaching of Moses was Islam, not Judaism. Therefore Allah says, only Islam is a religion which is acceptable in my sight. No such thing as Judaism or Christianity. Where did Christianity come from? The word Christianity, where did it originate? Did Jesus give his religion, says my religion is Christianity? Did he say I am the Christ? If you know that Christ is a Greek translation of the Hebrew word Messiah. Messiah in Arabic, Masih, means the anointed one. Priests and kings were anointed in consecration to their office, that from now on you are my high priest. From now on you are our king. So the Hebrew word for that is Messiah, one who is anointed. The Greek word for anointed is Christos. But Christos is a bit too long. So they lopped off the os and left with Christ. It is a Greek translation of the Hebrew word Messiah. Jesus never heard the term. He didn't hear the word Christ in his lifetime. Believe me. He didn't hear the word Christianity in his lifetime. It was unheard. It's a later on creation. And if we meet Jesus in his second coming, and if we have the good fortune of asking him, "Oh Jesus, what is your religion?" If he said Christianity, we can ask him further. Say, "Oh Jesus, tell us what church you belong to. Are you an Anglican or a Lutheran or Presbyterian or a Jehovah's Witness or a Seventh-day Adventist? What are you? What church you belong to?" Ridiculous, you agree. It's a ridiculous thing. What will he say? "What is the name of your religion, O Jesus? Tell us." And he will tell us that my religion is a religion of total submission to God's will. One word for that in the Arabic language is Islam. Islam means a religion of total submission to God's will. God says only Islam. Christianity is your creation. Where did the term come from? It is in the New Testament. That the enemies of the followers of Jesus, disparagingly they pointed to them at Antioch, and for the first time they use the term that these are Christians, meaning the worshippers of Christ. And the Christians like the term, so they adopted it, from which we get Christianity. Christianity was a term coined, invented by the enemies of the followers of Jesus. You like the term, you take it. You see, in my country, people call other people names. They call them names. Among the whites who are ruling the country, the majority are English and Afrikaner. The Afrikaner calls the Englishman Ruineck. Ruineck means rednecks. What they are trying to say is that this guy is a softy, he's effeminate. When he goes in the sun for a little while, he gets red in the neck. You know, he's a soft guy. That's what he means. It's a Ruineck. It means he's a softy. You know, effeminate chap. We are the boorers. You ask the Englishman says he's a boorer. Boorer means a farmer. But now, if you ask the Afrikaner what he is, he says, "I'm a boorer," means I'm a farmer. Nothing wrong with it. But when the Englishman calls him a boorer, he gets offended. Because when he says boorer, he's trying to imply that he's backward, rustic, farmer, uneducated, barbarian. Though he himself says, "I'm a boorer," but an English-speaking person says he's a boorer, meaning he is backward. But they call each other names. They call the colored community hot knots, means hottentots. They call my people coolies, laborers. They call the Africans Kaffirs. But now if you like the term, you adopt it. No Indian goes around in South Africa boasting I'm a coolie. No colored goes around boasting I'm a hot knot. No boorer goes around boasting I'm a boorer in the sense of a backward rustic. And no Englishman goes around boasting we are Ruinecks. But if you like the term, the choice is yours. The Christian made the choice. They liked what the enemies called them, and they accepted it. But the religion of Jesus, according to the definition he will give us, that my religion is a religion of total submission to God's will. One word for that in the Arabic language is Islam. And he is a Muslim. The Quran describes Jesus as a Muslim, his disciples as Muslims. What does it mean? That they followed Muhammad? No, they didn't hear the term Muhammad. Then what does Muslim mean? Muslim means one who has submitted his will to the will of God. Anyone who submits his will to the will of God, the Quran says Abraham was a Muslim, Moses was a Muslim, David, Solomon and Jesus were Muslims, Muhammad was a Muslim, and anyone, everyone who submits his will to the will of God is a Muslim. In the Garden of Gethsemane, we see this submission by Jesus, which qualifies him to be called a Muslim per excellence. He goes to the Garden of Gethsemane, according to the New Testament, and he tells his disciples, "Wait and watch," meaning keep guard. And he went a little further and fell on his face and prayed to God, said, "Oh my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass away from me," meaning remove the difficulty from me, "but not as I will, but as thou wilt." The expression, "not, but not as I will, what I want, but as thou wilt." Whatever you want me to do, whatever you want me to go through, oh my Lord, I am prepared to submit. The word for that in Arabic is aslama, submitting. He is a Muslim who has submitted. So Jesus was a Muslim, Moses was a Muslim, and if each and every one of us, we are prepared to submit to the will and plan of God, you are all Muslims. There is no such thing as Judaism, and there is no such thing as Christianity in the official books of the religion. Therefore, I say that there is no Judaism and no Christianity. But in the teachings, I say that actually there is no difference. In the fundamental principle of the teaching of Moses, Jesus and Muhammad, there is not an iota of difference, not one dot. I said in the fundamentals of the teachings of Moses, Jesus and Muhammad, even as recorded today in the Christian Bible, there is not an iota of difference. And I prove it to you. We want to know from the Jews. What is the first commandment? The most important thing in your faith. The first commandment, what is it? So he would tell you in the Hebrew language. If he knows, I asked an elderly Jew, I says, now, do you know the Shema? We say the Shahada. They say the Shema. I said, do you know the Shema? He said, my wife knows it at home. I said, no, I want to know whether you know it. However, the Shema is the Shahada of the Jew as given out, uttered by the Holy Prophet Moses. The Shema Israel Adonai Eloheinu Adonai Echad. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Some 1,300 years after Moses, Jesus Christ is on the scene. He is trying to reclaim his people, bring them out of formalism, ceremonialism, into the truth of God. Make them to accept the letter and the spirit. They are going for the letter of the law, they had forgotten the spirit. And as a reformer among the Jews, we believe as the Messiah, he had come to reclaim them, put them back onto the path. But his preaching, when he preached, the Jews, they thought something otherwise, that this man has brought another religion. Because the way he preached, he didn't preach like the other Jews. The other Jews always said, it is written. Moses said this, it is written, Isaiah said this, it is written, Jeremiah said this, everything it is written, 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 and they quote. Jesus doesn't speak like that. He says, it has been said by them of old time, thou shalt not commit adultery, but I say unto you, on a different level now, sounds different. I am telling you, you heard that you must not commit adultery. But I say unto you, whosoever looketh upon a woman to lust after her, had committed adultery with her already in his heart. He's speaking with authority, not what's written. What is written is there, but now I'm telling you this. You listen to me. Again, he says, it has been said by them of old time, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say unto you, resist not evil. He who strikes you in the right cheek, give him the other. It has been said by them of old time, that whosoever puts away his wife, let him give her a bill of divorcement. But I say unto you, that whosoever puts away his wife, save for the cause of fornication, causes her to commit adultery. And whosoever marries her that is divorced, committed adultery. You noted? But I say unto you, but I say unto you, but I say unto you, that created the wrong impression in the hearts and minds of the Jews, that this man has brought a new religion. So they come to him, Gospel of St. Mark chapter 12, verse 29, they come to him and they says, Master, in the Hebrew language, Rabbi. They were sarcastic, but they showed respect. Outwardly, he said, Master, Rabbi, Molvi Sahib, or Bishop, Bishop Sahib. What commandment is the first of all? And Jesus answers and says unto him, the first is, in the Hebrew language, he said, Shema Israel Adonai Eloheinu Adonai Echad. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. He repeated word for word what was given by Moses 1300 years before, without the change of a dot. Meaning that in the fundamentals of faith, no change. If treaty was what he, Trinity was what he had come to teach, that was the occasion for him to clarify himself that, look, you have been hearing about Shema Israel, Adonai Elohim, Adonai Echad. But now I'm telling you that for there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one. That was the occasion. But he didn't say any such thing. In other words, in the fundamentals of the faith, no change. Same. Some 600 years later, a Christian deputation comes to the Holy Prophet Muhammad from an area called Najran, and they were housed in the mosque of the Prophet for 3 days and three nights. They ate there, they slept there, and for 3 days and three nights they had a dialogue in the Masjid al-Nabawi, in the mosque of the Prophet. During the course of the discussion, the spokesman for the Christian poses the question, among so many other things. He says, all right, now tell us, O Muhammad, what is your concept of God? And he doesn't fumble. He doesn't say, well, you see, it's like this and like that and like that. He, so to say, presses his spiritual buttons. There were no buttons to press. I said, so to say, I hope you people, my brothers and sisters from India and Pakistan, they understand my English. It's very difficult for me to say things and then now you go along and say Muhammad was pressing his buttons, you know, to get his answers. I said, so to say, kehne ki baat, you, kehne ki baat, you kehte hain. So to say, he presses his spiritual buttons, asking, oh my Lord, what shall I say? Nobody heard him say that. But so to say, trying to contact the source of all knowledge, the head computer, as the Quran describes, بَلْ هُوَ قُرْآنٌ مَجِيدٌ فِي لَوْهِمْ مَحْفُوظٌ, that this is the glorious Quran from a tablet preserved. Anyone who has a connection with that, any prophet of God would have access to that type of knowledge. Like the end terminal of the computer system. You press the button and you get the information, your flights, timing, this, that, reservations, everything is on. So, what shall I say? Comes the answer from the head computer. Fi lawhim mahfuz, from the preserved tablet, saying through his mouth, using him as a mouthpiece. So, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ, say, he is God the one and only. Allahu Samad, God the Eternal Absolute. Lam yalid wa lam yulad, he does not beget and is not begotten. Wa lam yakun lahu kufuwan ahad, and there is nothing like unto him. A touchstone of theology in four verses. There isn't a theology on earth which these four verses do not cover. Come with any idea of your concept of God. Either with these four verses, we accept or we reject. This is the touchstone of theology. Four verses, he uttered them. He said, say, he is God the one and only. If the Christians had the presence of mind, they could have asked him, he said, what do you mean, say? We want you to tell us, and you're saying, say. Why do you say, say? If I posed a question to you, you know arithmetic, and if you know the 12 time table, I'm asking, what is 12 times 12? Answer, anybody know? 12 times 12, what is it? Huh? 144. Right, correct. 6 times 6? Right. You don't say 144. You don't say 36, do you? If you said that, I said, what do you say? Say, why must... I'm asking you, what is 6 times 6? So you say 36. What is 12 times 12? You say 144. You don't say. If you ask Muhammad, if they had asked, why do you say, I'm asking you, why do you say, he is Allah, the one and only? He says, no, I'm told to say that, as if he's only being used as a speaker in the radio. From the head computer, it's being transmitted through him, the message comes, say, he is Allah the one and only. Allah the eternal absolute. He does not beget and is not begotten. And there's nothing like unto him. And back to normal speech. He was speaking on a certain level, normal communication. Then all of a sudden, he goes into another level, which is not his. قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. And back to normal. I say, you see, this is our concept of God, my brothers. You understand? This is so. So, first words, قل هو الله أحد. Say, He is Allah, the one and only. Moses said, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Jesus said, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Muhammad is made to say, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ وَحَدْ. Say, He is Allah, the one and only. What is the difference? It's the same message, meaning the same thing. So in the fundamentals of the teachings of Moses, Jesus and Muhammad, there is not an iota of difference. What was Moses teaching? Islam. What was Jesus teaching? Islam. What was Muhammad teaching? Islam. Submission to the will of God. But today we have some variations. We want to know now solutions to our problems. God Almighty was guiding the children of Israel through Moses. They had been liberated from the Egyptian bondage in the Sinai Peninsula. They were marching from one oasis to another. And they were supposed to do that for 40 years. 40 years, on and on and on and on and on, till the older generation, the people who had worshipped the golden calf, would perish. A new generation would go into Palestine. That was the philosophy behind marching for 40 years. In the desert, the Jews, the children of Israel, they needed a law. A law that would give them quick justice. An eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. Beautiful law. In the desert, it's a beautiful law. The adulterer and the adulteresses stone them to death. Anybody picking a firewood, doing any work on the Sabbath day, Yom Saturday, kill him, stone him to death. That's the only language they could understand. A rebellious people, as Moses describes them. He says, behold, a stiff-necked people. This is Moses, the prophet, saying, a stiff neck means arrogant people. He says, ye, you have been rebellious against the law since the day I knew you. This is your tradition from the very beginning. Since I know you, you are like that. For such a people, you need a law, hard law, stern law. It's a beautiful law. The law is made for your needs. So eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. You were trying to chase the birds from the field with that old-fashioned sling of yours, the one that David used. And the stone which you let go went and damaged somebody's eye. So this other Jew will go to the judge and says, look, this fellow here, he damaged my eye. The law says, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. I want to have his eye damaged. He broke my tooth, break his teeth. This was the law, nothing wrong with it. For a type of people in the desert, you need a law that will give you quick justice. No time to waste, no lengthy litigations, no prisons that you can put the guy in. Quick justice, get rid of the guy and the social character and move on. There's work to be done. This guy is an adulterer, he committed adultery. Your law, the Jewish law, allowed the guy unlimited number of wives. Why did you interfere with somebody else's wife or daughter? You deserve to die. There's no prisons in the desert. Leaving the guy in the desert to die of hunger and thirst was more cruel than getting rid of him by stoning him. Get rid of him, and he becomes an object lesson for others. See what happens? You do the same, you go the same way. This is the philosophy of the law. Eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. Beautiful law. But laws have a tendency to change characters of people over a period of time. Any law, every law. I come from a color-conscious country, South Africa. Everything is based on color. The South African government, in the apartheid policy, they graded us into blacks, coloreds, blacks, coloreds, Indians and whites. And that part, for 300 years, almost, white man, colored man, Indian man, and African man. Then they divided the black further. First is white and black. Everyone who is a European is white. Everyone who is not a European is black. No matter how white you look. Where do you come from? You come from Lebanon? If you are a Muslim, you are black. If you come from Lebanon, you are a Christian, you are white. If you come from Syria, no matter how white you look, whiter than many English people, some Syrians look, you know. You come from Syria, you are a Christian, you are white. If you are a Muslim, you are black. You come from Cyprus, you are a Greek, you are white, no matter how dark you are. The Turk with blonde hair and blue eyes, he's black. Well, look, this is the last laugh you're going to have, because that system is now officially abolished in the country. But I'm just giving you history now. This is up to yesterday. This was so. Now, once you have such a law, your mind is working on basis of color. I have had hundreds of whites, Jews and Christians coming to my home. And I enjoy feeding people. Our hospitality, our food, our bhajas and samosas, they lap it up. The white man, the white woman, they eat like mad. I said, in English terminology, I said, they hog it. And when they part, they thank me profusely. The white people are good. They thank you profusely. You know, we enjoyed everything. The chat as well as the food. But subsequently, when they meet me in the street, they say, good morning, Mr. Dida. I say, good morning. I say, how's the wife? I say, she's very fine. How the family is very good. But no white man has invited me to his house for a cup of tea yet. So I'm asking the guys, I said, don't you people know anything, such a thing as reciprocation? Huh? You uncultured, barbaric people, you don't know reciprocation? No, you know. You know reciprocation. Then how is it that you eat my food, you enjoy my food, but you don't call me for a cup of tea at your house? Why? I know the reason why. That color consciousness. If he invites me and my family, and I go to the elite, we are all separated into races. The white man living in his area, the Indian in his area, the colored in his area, and the African in his reserves. So if he invites me, and I go with my family, with our, you know, our type of dressing, Pakistani or Hindustani Muslims, the way we dress, long pants for the ladies and nice downy covering the body and all that, long dress. And I go and knock at the door, I find number 10 Downing Street there, and I go and knock at the door, and the gentleman or the lady of the house, she opens the door and recognizes, oh, Mr. Didat, come in, we are so happy you visiting us. And we get into the house. People were watching. The other whites were watching, somebody watering the garden, somebody doing some hoeing in the garden. They were watching, so where is this coolie going with his family? What is this guy doing around here? You know? And look at that, Mrs. Smith, the way she smiles at this coolie. You know, what's going on? And we go inside, maybe a cup of tea and something little more than a cup of tea, some biscuits and things like that. And half an hour goes, an hour goes, and tongues begin to wag. They want to know what's going on. What is Mrs. Smith doing with this coolie family? And if any relations of Mrs. Smith or Mr. Smith comes into the house, this Mr. Smith must go out of his way to explain our presence there. It won't be like one English people to another, say, look, this is Mr. Brown and Mrs. Brown. No. He must say, look, this is Mr. Didat, and you know, we went to his house, and you know, his hospitality, he fed us with wonderful fruit, and he must now, actually, he's apologizing for my presence. My family's presence there. He knows that. So at the back of the mind, the color is coming in. So he eats my food, but he never gives me a cup of tea. Not that he doesn't know reciprocation, sociability. He knows all that. But that's only between white and white, not between brown and white difference. So laws have a tendency to change the characters of people. Hitlerite Germany. And land of Goethe and Beethoven, a very cultured nation, a Christian nation. They incinerated 6 million Jews. Some say it's a fib. I said even 600 is bad enough. On racial grounds, you want to kill a people because they are Jews or they are Indians or whatever. I say unforgivable. If they commit murder, you can hang him. Okay. The gas chamber, okay. He's a rapist, chop off his head. I said, okay. Whether Jew or Christian or Muslim or anybody. But you kill a man because he's a Jew. He didn't choose himself to be a Jew. He was born into the world of Jew, in the home of a Jew. He had no voluntary choices. Look, I'll go and be born in the home of a Jew. He didn't decide that. It's just a matter of accident that he happens to be a Jew, and you kill him for that. 600 and 6 unforgivable on the basis of race. But they say 6 million, they say let's accept 6 million. You start wondering, how can such a cultured nation as the Germans, the land of Goethe and Beethoven, do such a horrible crime? I say very easy, if you are programmed that way. Over a period, these Jews, these are parasites, they are Christ killers, they kill our God. And it has been happening for 1,000 years. In Europe, in Russia, in Poland, in France, in Britain, every Easter the Christian goes on to a rampage. He says, these are Christ killers, they kill our God. So they kill their men, they rape their women and burn their homes. And they fled. Where do they go to? To Arab lands. And what does the Arab say? Ahlan wa sahlan. Wallah, that's his nature, that's his culture. Meaning family and play. Just think that you are a member of the family and be at ease. Make yourself feel at home. 1,000 years this has been going on. No problem. There was no problem between the Jew and the Muslim. No problem. It's a different subject. But I must just end with the sentence that the first time any trouble took place, real trouble between the Jew and the Arab, was when the Arabs heard that the British government thinks with favor of the establishment of a Jewish state in Palestine. So what is this now? This is my country. For the first time, the Arab realizes that this is my country, and this man here, you know, he wants to give my country away to somebody else. So he starts protesting, but he is not organized, he is not educated, so he makes a bad job of it. And he lost it. But between the Jew and the Muslim, no problem. In Spain, the Muslims ruled Spain for 800 years. The golden age of the Jew, ask any Jew, your golden age, the highest that you reached in civilization and culture, when? They say, under the Muslims in Spain. The golden age of the Muslim was the golden age of the Jew. When we were kicked out, they were kicked out. When the Muslims were kicked out of Spain, the Inquisition, the Jews were kicked out, and they came to Britain, they went to France and other places. But our suffering was their suffering. Our honor and dignity was their honor and dignity. That is how we live. Religiously, there was no problem. No Jew ever killed a Muslim saying, kill him because he's a Muslim. No Muslim ever killed a Jew because he's a Jew. Individually, things could have happened. Brothers do kill brothers. Cain killed Abel. It happens all the time. But as a race, riots against the Jews, persecution of the Jews, never. Problem starts with 1918, the Balfour Declaration. However, we want a solution today. I am saying in all humility that the only system, deen, the way of life, that can bring these three warring factions, though we are not at war with the sword and the gun with the Christians, but there is a battle on, battle royal, for the hearts and souls of mankind. The Christians are making tremendous efforts to convert the Muslim world. There are at the present moment 35,000 crusaders raising the dust in Africa. There are 6,000 crusaders in Indonesia. So far, they have converted 15 million Indonesians into Christianity. And by the turn of the century, they want to make Indonesia a Christian nation. They have converted more Pakistanis into Christianity since independence than in the previous 100 years of British rule. They have converted more Bangladeshis into Christianity since independence, since 1947, than in the previous 100 years of British rule. They are going all out. Colonialism is gone. Politically, they can't rule the people anymore. But now, in the guise of religion, they're making a comeback. The war is on. Intellectual battle is on. But what have you to offer? Solution to the problems of mankind. Jesus Christ, in the Gospel of St. John, he says, I have yet many things to say unto you, but ye cannot bear them now. I have solution to the problems of mankind till doomsday, till the end of the world. I can give you those guidance, how to solve your problems, any problem, every problem. But you are incapable of receiving that. Ye cannot bear them now. Howbeit, when He, the Spirit of Truth, is come, He will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak from himself, but whatsoever shall he hear, that shall he speak, and he shall declare unto you the things that are to come. He shall glorify me. He's telling you honestly, I can give you solutions, but you are like little children. You can't grasp, you don't understand what I'm telling you. Whatever I'm telling you, everything you misunderstand. Everything. That's a tall statement. But the history of that statement is writ large in the Holy Bible. Again and again we read Jesus reprimanding his disciples. He's saying, ye of little faith, you got no faith, no iman, be iman, ye of little faith, how many times, again and again. And he explains to them as if he's explaining to little children, and they can't seem to grasp the message. So he says, I even yet, without understanding, even yet. And when he's provoked further, he says, O faithless and perverse generation. That's his disciples, not the generality of Jews. He called them other names. You generation of vipers, you whited sepulchres, you hypocrites, you wicked and adulterous generation, you know the law. But he's now telling his disciples, so, O faithless and perverse generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I be with you? I'm saying that if Jesus was a Japanese instead of a Jew, he would have committed that honorable harakiri, suicide. But as a Jew, he can't afford to do that. He loves life, like we all love life. So he says, howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak. Now if I quote this, you see, if you ask any Christian missionary, who is the Spirit of truth? He says, the Holy Ghost. He will tell you it's the Holy Ghost. Ask him, you got the Holy Ghost? He said, yes. Your church? He said, yes. Every church and denomination in Christendom claim the gift of the Holy Ghost. The Holy Spirit, they call it. You ask the Jehovah's Witness, you got it? He said, yes. Seventh-day Adventist, you got it. The Anglican has got it. The Lutheran has got it. The Roman Catholic, everyone. 1,000 sects and denomination among the whites of South Africa in my country, they got it. And 3,000 among the blacks, sects and denominations, they got it. What, the Holy Ghost? I'm asking, what did the Holy Ghost tell you in 2,000 years? Which Jesus already didn't give it to you in so many different words. Give me one. Only one new thing. Jesus, I have yet many. I said, in English, many means more than one. He will guide you into all truth. I said, all in English means more than one. I don't want more than one. I want only one. And for 40 years, I'm asking, learned men of Christianity, give me one new thing that the Holy Ghost gave you in 2,000 years to any church. Any church. Bring it. I want to hear. There is it. I said, we have problems. The biggest problem is race. In the world today, race, racism. We are all racists. I said, we are all racists. Nobody is exempt from this devilishness, this sickness of racism. No matter how much we boast. We Muslims might say that we are the least racist. But you can't say we are pure from that sickness. Nobody is pure. The Jews said we are the children of Abraham. We are the children of David. The rest of the world, we are the children of Israel. The rest of the world was Goyim. What is Goyim? Ask him. Gentile. What is Gentile? Unclean. Filthy, dirty, uncircumcised people. You. Pig eaters. You. That's how he is. The rest of the world. The Arab. You know what the Arab said? He says, we are the Arabs. You know what it means? We are an eloquent people. You see, in my language, the Arab says, I can give you 100 synonyms for a sword. I can give you 100 synonyms for a horse. In your language, how many can you give? Maybe half a dozen. Half a dozen for a horse. Half a dozen for a sword. He said, you see, compared to me, you are dumb. So he said, you are ajam. Ajam means dumb. We are the Arabs, the eloquent people, and the rest of the world is dumb, like animals. That's his racism. And my people in India, we say we are the Aryans, we are the master race. And the rest of the India are Achut, untouchables. Ask the British, they'll tell you something about themselves as against the other. Ask the Germans, they'll tell you something as against the other. This is man, any man, every man. sickness, that we are all sick. Now, how to eliminate this sickness? You see, it's very easy for anybody to talk about the fatherhood of God and the brotherhood of man. Very easy. There is but only one Father, our Creator, Lord and Cherisher, God Almighty. And we are all His children. That's talk. 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 How do you implement it? System. You require a system. Talking is easy. Preaching is easy. How do you implement that brotherhood? Judaism hasn't got it. Christianity hasn't got it. Jesus Christ himself, he discriminated in his own time. He says, I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. I have only come for the Jews. He's telling his disciples, go ye not into the way of the Gentiles and into any city of the Samaritans, enter ye not, but go ye rather unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. That's what he did. Himself in his lifetime, he never preached to a single non-Jew. In his lifetime. A Greek woman, she had a problem. Her daughter was suffering some incurable sickness. So she brings her daughter to him. He said, Master, heal my daughter. So he turns his face away. She goes on the other side. He said, Master, please. Drowning men clutches at straws. Drowning women do the same. My daughter's life is at stake. Please help her. So the disciples said, look, this woman, she won't let us go. She'll pester us, our life out of her. Heal her daughter. So he says, do not throw the bread of the children to the dogs. These Greeks are dogs. My children are the Jews. What I brought, the spiritual blessing. He's not talking about bread. He's talking about spiritual blessings. Goodness, is that is for my children, the Jews. These rest of them, the Greeks and the Romans and all, are dogs. You mustn't throw. Do not throw that which is holy unto dogs. Do not throw pearls before swine. I'm asking, who are the dogs and who are the swines? The non-Jew. That's his teaching. Now, man, you say, now we open our churches to all races now. After 300 years in South Africa, for the first time, they say, now we open our churches to all people. After 300 years. For 300 years, you can't have a black bishop. You had to rule every Christian. In Indonesia, in India, wherever the white man must rule. You held the reins. Because you were racist. Now, Jesus had given it to you. He said, no, my children and the dogs are separate things. In his lifetime, now this woman, she is a drowning person. Her daughter's life is at stake. So she says, Master, even the dogs have crumbs from the master's table. That was too much for him. So he said, give her the crumbs. And the daughter was healed. The crumbs of the blessings. His food, his bread, was for his own children, the Jews. But I say, system, even whatever you claim, you require a system to change the hearts and minds of people. Now, the Muslim is the only guy who has the system. 5 times a day, the muazzin, the caller, goes on top of the minaret and he shouts in a loud, sonorous voice, say, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Say, Allah is the greatest, Allah is the greatest. He repeats it 4 times. Say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. He said, I bear witness that there is no other object to worship but Allah, God Almighty. He's the only one who deserves to be worshipped. He repeats it twice. He said, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. He said, I bear witness that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. He's not God, he's not his son. Don't make a mistake like the others have done. They made the prophets into gods, they made the heroes into gods. Don't you do that. The Muslim is warned. And alhamdulillah, this sickness hasn't got us yet. Of worshipping Muhammad as a god. There isn't such thing. He repeats it twice. Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. If you accept these two fundamentals, that there is but one God and Muhammad is the messenger. What is the message? He continues, Hayya ala salat, he says, come to prayer. Hayya ala salat, he says, come to prayer. Hayya ala al-falah, he says, come to success. Because this is real success. That you remind yourselves about your duties and obligations towards your Creator and your duties and obligations towards your fellow human beings. If you want to be successful, there is no other way. And he winds up the call by saying, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Allah is still the greatest, Allah is still the greatest. Whether you come or you don't come, you are not going to lower him in his exaltation, in his majesty, in his glory. He will ever remain supreme. And the final words of warning, the muazzin gives, the caller gives, La ilaha illallah. that there is no other object of worship but Allah. You can carry on worshipping your man gods, your women gods, your money gods, but remember this, that the only one who deserves to be worshipped is Allah. And the Muslim hearkens to the call. Holy Prophet Muhammad said that when you stand up for prayer, you must not leave gaps for the devil to get in between you and your brother. This devil that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was talking about was not the guy we see in our art galleries. In my country, in Durban, there's a huge painting by some great artist. You see in that painting a beautiful woman with wings, well proportioned, and she's got a wand in her hand, and she's directing the devil to go to hell. And in the picture you can see the devil flying off, ruddy complexion, red, with horns and sharp ears and a tail with a barbed hook. And you see the hellfire in the distance. In the picture you can see all that. I said, Muhammad wasn't talking about that. A devil like that with a tail with a barbed hook. I said, if you see one, you run for dear life. Me too, I run for dear life. You stand there and reason with him? You listen to him? Never. Devil comes in a beautiful form. Allah makes things appealing to you so you get caught. He comes in that form, you run. Muhammad wasn't talking about that. He was talking about you, yourself. He was talking about you, your racial pride, your arrogance, your riches. I am white, he's black. I am rich, he's poor. That devil must not be allowed to come in between you and your brother. No gaps left. This is what Muhammad, 5 times a day, we get together and we finish off our prayer. Go and watch them in the mosque. Sometimes prayer time. Ask the Muslim friends if you know. They say, look, we want to see how you people pray. And you watch. When they finish off, they say, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. So peace and blessings of God to everybody to the right of me. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. So peace and blessings of God to everybody to the left of me. When I did this, I see an African there. When I did that, I see a Chinese here. When I did it again next time, I see a white man there. Next time, I see a colored guy there. I see an Eskimo this side. So in my heart and mind, this is my brother, this is my brother, this is my brother, this is my brother. System of eliminating this racism. We are still racist. The sickness is there, it hasn't left us. But the system makes you the least racist. I'm still ashamed to say that we are not free from the sickness. Whether you're a Pakistani, or you're a Bangladeshi, or you're a Punjabi, or you're a Turk, or you're an Arab, I say we are all sick. The system is there to eliminate these feelings of racism out of you. Then on a Friday, bigger gathering. Then once in a lifetime you go for pilgrimage, and there you see, this is the Chinese Muslims, and the guy from Ethiopia is black as coal, my brother. And the guy from Turkey with blonde hair and blue eyes, my brother. I didn't imagine all this. To me, all Muslims are sort of look like me. Now I see an Ethiopian is a Muslim, and a Madrasi is a Muslim, and a Chinese is a Muslim. My brother. A system of bringing people together and working out this poison of racism. Alcohol, the only system on earth which says don't touch that abomination is Islam. Allah says in the Quran, Ya ayyuhallazina amanu, O you who believe, innamal khamru, most certainly intoxicants, wal maisiru, and gambling, wal ansabu, and fortune telling, wal azlamu, and idol worship, rizum min amali shaitan, are an abomination of Satan's handiwork. Fajtanibuhu la'allakum tuflihun. So shun such abomination that you may prosper. 4 evils, 1 stroke, slash them all. I didn't know time flies so fast in London. Mr. Chairman and my dear brothers and sisters, I would rather leave this meeting open for questions. Maybe you have something you want to ask me. But otherwise, I can keep you here till midnight. I won't be deriving any pleasure out of that, nor will you. I now leave this meeting as the chairman dictates or explains to you how this system of questioning will work. وَآخُرُ الدَّعْوَانَ عَنِ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ